Everyone, welcome to Magic TV. I am Tristan Shaun Gregson, here with Luis Scott-Vargas, and it's the most wonderful time of the year.
Christmas?
Second or third most. It's spoiler season.
Oh, yeah, okay. Yeah, that works. Spoiler season is pretty good. It's the most wonderful time of the year, and it happens a bunch of times.
Right, that's why we're here. We like this a lot. We want Christmas five times a year.
You can probably get more presents this time, too.
Yes. It's spoiler season, so it's spoiler episode one for here, us on Channel Fireball. I can't even say that right. Let's just dive right into it, then, and we'll just gloss over this fact. Let's talk first about Gristlebrand.
Well, it's a nice name, first of all. It's got the combination of gristle, which is always good, and it's, you know, heavily branded, but...
Luis, gristle, always good.
Gristleback? Delicious gristle.
That's a card, too, isn't it?
No. Yes, gristleback.
Yeah, there we go. Yes.
That's what I said, delicious gristle. You eat the gristleback, and you get the life.
This time, this guy's eating your life, and you're getting cards. And
he really should have cost seven.
I know, the major complaint. I knew you were going to say this right away.
Come on, how can you not? He's 7-7, Avacyn's an 8-8 for 8. He pays 7, you draw 7. And if you wanted to adjust it power level-wise, make it like 5 black, 2 colorless. That's a cool casting cost that's also never been done as far as I know.
I don't think so either.
I don't even know if 4 black and 4 has ever been done. So.
No, have they gone past the quad black?
I don't know, quintuple black would be nice. What if they're like sextuple black, like 7, just 7 ball, 7 black mana?
It would probably fit with the name, because that's always been the issue in the past on cards, is it couldn't be...
Oh yeah, and Gristlebrand's a short name, so...
Yeah, that would be...
Of course, then it restricts it to just mono black, and I think this card's good enough to get played in other decks. I mean, it's 1 mana more than I'd like to pay for a Game Ender. Like, Karn is already pushing it at 7, and then you've got Sphinx and Titan and whatnot at 6. But honestly, if you cast this guy, he is very good. I mean, against some decks, they're not getting out of the deal with you not drawing, you know, less than 7. And the lifelink obviously helps, you know, balance out the fact that you're paying 7 and whatnot.
So, the fact that it costs 8 is probably a good thing for Constructed Magic. However...
Yes.
The first thought...
And Limited Magic, honestly.
Yeah. The first thought when I actually saw this card was, wow, maybe this 5-color reanimator deck just got a new tool.
Yeah, I mean, he's great if you reanimated him. Like, he's kind of like a Jin Gataxias that doesn't die to removal, or rather dies to removal, but you get to use it first. Though, in Legacy, casting actual reanimate on him is a little sketchier.
Okay, I was small-balling this one. I was thinking Standard, you could...
Yeah, in Standard I like it, because, I mean, again... Right now, the Fritz deck does not have a good reanimation target against control decks, because almost anything you get just gets Doombladed or Go for the Throat, and, you know, there's not that much of a way around it, but Gristlebrand does a pretty good job of getting around that.
I mean, how unrealistic would it be to, against that kind of blue-black or Esper control deck that already doesn't have any threats, now it's like, reanimate this guy, draw 14,
yeah,
fill your graveyard with all the tools you need to kind of like out card advantage the control deck, and then like there's your game.
Yeah, you draw 14, discard 2 Unburial Rites, 3 Fatties, a Tracker's Instincts, and like 2 land or a Lingering Souls or something.
Seems pretty nice.
Yeah, yeah. I think it's feasible. I think, you know, Delicious Gristle will be consumed in in Standard in the next couple months.
So obviously Limited Bomb might even be castable.
Let's not get too far ahead of ourselves here. It costs 8 mana. It is a bomb if you resolve it, but at 8 mana, like, I don't know. I mean,
there's so many angels, it seems.
I would not be surprised if you would be taking good uncommons over him. That being said, if the format's slow enough, if it's slow like Rise, our last, you know, single small set or single large-ish set, then, yeah, in Rise, it would have been insane. A great bomb. But in Zendikar, it would have been stone unplayable. So we have to see where it falls on the Zendikar to Rise scale of drafting.
Right. I mean, it's actually a good way for us to kind of stop and have a quick side note about that in limited format. The last time we had this kind of large set that we drafted all by itself was Rise of the Eldrazi. Rise of the Eldrazi, top 3 draft formats of all time?
Something like that. It was really good.
Incredible. Because, again, you could play Ulamog, or you could play, you know, level up guys down low.
Or you could play, like the token, like, you know, Birthing Spawn and, you know, Raid Bombardment and, like, Essence Feed and all the token-making cards and Emrakul's Hatcher and those combos or aggressive level decks or the super ramp. The fact that, Ulamog was a good card and that was awesome. I mean...
So it would be nice. I mean, we've only seen 20 or so cards at this point while we're filming this, but we have, you know, that kind of big top-end filled in for us. This is going to be a set we're going to draft 3 by itself. And then we've seen some fairly aggressive guys, some tricks down low.
And then, like, the Soulbond guys are also... fairly aggressive because they reward you for having like lots of small guys like the Ophidian guy or the Death Touch. Well, the Death Touch guy is more defensive, but or you know the rare double striking guy. Like these are guys that you're looking to like curve out into, which does not bode well for cards like Gristlebrand. On the other hand, he has 7/7 lifelink, and so well, unlike a lot of game-ending bombs, he actually does end the game if they can't remove him. If they can't remove him, how are they attacking into him? You're getting seven and blocking their biggest guy.
That lifelink is a big deal. That way, if you, you know, obviously in limited, you know, you're going to be at probably less than seven life probably when he hits the table against those aggressive decks. Yeah. But still, you have the lifelink, you're coming out of that hole, you know, etc.
Yeah, that's the problem with something like Sphinx of Dwar Isle, you know, in Zendikar, where six was almost as much as eight. It is in a normal format. You'd play Sphinx, and it would block one guy, but they would still just kill you with the rest of their guys. Or the problem with something like, you know, Mindslaver or whatever, where, yeah, you cast it, and it's good if you untap, but Griselmon's good immediately. You just play him, and, I mean, yeah, they can remove him and kill you, but if they can't remove him, they're probably not killing you.
All right, moving on. We've already touched on some of the other cards that are on here, but let's talk about Restoration Angel.
Yeah, the new Splinter Twin combo. Well, Kiki Jiki, not Splinter Twin.
Oh, okay.
Just Kiki Jiki. It's obviously not going to be used for that because you'd rather have Pestermite and Splinter Twin. But yeah, I mean, Restoration Angel is also a good cube card, I think. I mean, depending on the cube.
We agree on that one. I mean, a 3/4 flash for 4 that flickers something of yours.
Yeah, I mean, it's a 3/4 flying for 4 flash that, yeah, is going to draw you a card about, like, some number of the times it comes into play by saving one of your guys or triggering a come-to-play ability that you like. And, I mean, I think in your cube, a 3/4 for 4 is just above the curve anyway. Like, it doesn't even have to have flying or flash.
Just
prove me wrong.
It flickers Ogre Arsonist, which is a pretty big game.
It's true. I like that curve. I like the curve of, you know, Avalanche Riders, untap, upkeep, flicker this guy. Bam.
I like what I'm hearing. I'm not going to lie. That's pretty good. Sure. I mean, you know, if we're going to play it in Standard today, is it more of a Birthing Pod card? Is it like...
It's not really a Birthing Pod card, I don't think. I mean, you get to re-trigger something, but Birthing Pod goes up the curve. So, like, what are you sacking? Like, what are you sacking that will leave you with a guy with a good coming to play ability that hasn't already been pretty good, right? Like, you can't sack Bladesplicer into this and get another Bladesplicer token.
True.
I mean, it's kind of cool in those decks, but those decks, when they have a Birthing Pod and a guy who's already triggered a coming to play ability out, you don't need something that's only good in that situation. You want, and even just playing it to randomly, like, cast Acidic Slime, then cast this as a copy of Acidic Slime, it's like...
Marcus Conley when you need him. That's so good.
I mean, there's stuff, but I don't know if this fixes the... Birthing Pod's bad when it doesn't have Birthing Pod, and when its guys aren't really doing much. This only duplicates something you've already done.
But it gives you a little more reach here. For example, let's say you don't have Pod. You Huntmaster, you pass. Like, you ideally, there's some sequence in which you flip it. Let's say it's your turn.
And then you play the Angel to flip it again.
Yeah, you flip it back, and then you know...
Yeah, I mean, that's cool, but, like... Is it better than just, like, you know, playing more Huntmasters in your deck and more cards that do things on their own? What if you don't draw the Huntmaster?
The fact that they all cost 4 is very aggravating.
Yeah, I mean, I think the card is cool, and I could see it, you know, seeing play in, like, as, like, a 2 or 3 of, and, you know, as the top of the curve in an aggressive deck, because, yeah, saving your guy and playing a beefy 3/4, like, in humans, it's a way for humans to have a guy that doesn't, you know, get played main phase. So it makes humans way better against Mana Leak if you're running some of these. But it also doesn't really combo with much in that deck, and unless they have removal like Pacifism, not Oblivion Ring, like it's a little less good, right? It doesn't save your guys as much.
Yeah.
But it's also, again, the stats and the ability combined to make an interesting enough card that I would really not be surprised if it saw some play.
It's going to do lots of things, regardless of how good or bad they're going to be. I'm sure, I'm already dreaming of scenarios where it's like, oh, I attack with my guys recklessly of Saintraft, and then I can bring it back, so I hit you for 4. And
yeah, I mean, that is good. And it's not terrible. It can also ambush opposing guys if you need to.
Yeah, these are all things. These are things that happen. I don't know who ordered this list, but next on my list here,
TSG.
I must have been. I have Temporal Mastery.
Oh, yeah, this one.
How would we like to tackle this card?
So, it's funny, because this card has a lot of things going for it, and a lot of things going against it, and my natural inclination is to say, like, man, people are overhyping it, it's too much. I don't want to put a damper on people's excitement, because this card is very exciting, and is going to lead to some really nice sequences of plays. Can you imagine, like, having a Delvera, like, reveal this, like, you know, you get to reveal that, flip your Delver, time walk, play a land, hit him. But can you also imagine having this in your opening hand or drawing it on turn one and just like, oh my god. Like, cards like this make Miracle awesome, but they also kind of ensure that they're not going to reprint a Brainstorm type effect. I mean, you know, it's not going to happen that they're going to let you have an easy way of putting cards back on top of your deck, because if it's too good, then this Time Walk becomes degenerate, and this Time Walk certainly has the power available to be just insanely good.
With the onset of Miracle, things we know for sure, Jace the Mind Sculptor will not be unbanned in Modern. No form of Ponder will be reprinted in M13.
No, Ponder doesn't work with this card. I thought the same thing. But I was talking to Pat Chapin, and he was pointing out that, like, why is Ponder good with this card? And it's just like, well, yeah, why is it good with this card?
I mean, it's for your next turn, right?
Sure, but like, what? So, what? In what situation is Ponder awesome? I mean, it's okay. It's not like insane though. So, let's say you cast Ponder and this was your top card. Well, then you have to put it second, draw your card, and the next turn you draw the Miracle card.
Yeah.
But you would have just drawn the Miracle card anyway, right?
I guess, yeah.
If it's like anywhere in your top three, like if it's second or third, you're speeding it up by a turn, but that's all you're doing. If it's first, then you don't do anything. Like, pondering is not making this incredibly more likely to happen, is my point. And what if you ponder and shuffle and draw it off the shuffle? Then you can't even cast it.
Yeah.
So,
yeah.
Like, it's deceptive. I thought the exact same thing, but looking at it, yeah, ponder and miracle cards don't overlap as much as you might think they would. People are used to ponder being insane with Delver, and like, oh yeah, miracle's just like Delver. But the fact that you the draw off ponder can't trigger the miracle card does actually change it. On the other hand, Desperate Ravings and other instant speed card draw does help to some extent. Not because it lets you miracle when you wouldn't have miracled otherwise, or like, you know, if it's the top card, you're still going to miracle on your turn. But it lets you, you know, do stuff like cast Thunderous Blow or whatever, the five damage one, on their turn when you normally only miracling on your turn.
So, you know, I actually haven't had stopped to think about this yet. How does that interaction work
It's actually funny. So, you cast Desperate Ravings. You draw your first card carefully, because when you have miracle cards in your deck, everyone knows to draw them carefully, right?
Yeah, it's gonna change.
You don't want to be the guy who just peels the miracle card and realizes he can't cast it.
Just resolve Desperate Ravens where you normally would, which is put two cards into your hand.
You look at the first card. If it's the miracle card, show them, put it in your hand, put the second card in your hand, because you can't cast miracle off the second one. Shuffle your hand, discard a card, hope it's not the miracle card, and then miracle them.
So if it goes to your graveyard, you can't cast it.
Yeah. Though, actually, I don't know how that works. What if you already have one of the miracle cards in your hand? How do you track which one's which?
Awkward.
All right. Well, I thought I knew the answer, but I do know that you don't cast the miracle card during the Desperate Ravings.
That I 100% agreed with. It was no problem. My questions were, let's say it's a card you discarded. Is it some kind of trigger that allows you to still cast
it?
It
works a lot better online. Let's just put it that way.
Yes. If my hand is triple manipulation, and I have a Desperate Ravings, and I show you that if the fourth one, and then you're like, okay, go ahead, discard something. That would be pretty bad, though.
Do you have to call a judge, then?
Oh, well, you know, our video editor, Tim Froling, remember when we had the talk about Sylvan Library brainstorming, and how it's like, you know, of cards you've drawn this turn. That's one of the rare circumstances in Magic right now, where you have to physically call a judge over and be like, all right, I've brainstormed this turn, watch me brainstorm. Now I'm going to use my draw step to use Sylvan Library. These are all the options I have to choose from.
Yeah, but like, it's so bad, because what if you cast, Desperate Ravings, you reveal Temporal Manipulation, and you just, you know, you just roll a dice.
Right.
Because you only have one, so it doesn't matter, right? You don't hit it, you take an extra turn.
Sure.
Next time, you cast Desperate Ravings, you flash it back even, you draw Temporal Manipulation, like, oh, I've got to call a judge. That's just telling them you have a second one in your hand. Right?
Or you can go a level deeper.
You can call judge the first time. Yeah. Which is... All right, we'll see how this plays out. I don't want to do too much baseless speculation. Though that is the best kind of speculation.
Hopefully our 3 minutes on it will have led someone to some kind of FAQ or something where we can get this resolved.
Seems easily manipulated. Let's just put it that way.
Always an opening. So it's fun. It's good. You know, the other questions around it.
It is fun. I do want to say that. And that's like, in a lot of ways, the most important thing. Because most of the rules questions and all that is just not relevant to the fact that when you have miracle cards in your deck and you need a miracle, you're just going to be like, it's just very exciting. Every draw step's exciting.
Yeah.
You've made every draw step in your entire game more interesting once you have the mana for a miracle. That seems like a success.
It's similar to the, you know, lining up my mana
to cast the cruel tomb,
you know. Or if you're playing against Luis in a cube draft, he'll just turn the top card of his library over when you're at three and lightning bolt you immediately, like not even thinking about it. Oh, it's a mountain? Oh, wait, next turn you're dead.
Or it involves the miracle card, which I believe will have already been previewed by me by the time this episode goes live, which is also exciting.
I don't know what's going on.
I can't tell you now because it's technically before that time.
I understand that. Oh, no.
The timing of this feels like temporal manipulation to me.
We got to move on. In summation, miracle, we like it.
Miracles happen.
It's not terrible. It's already leading to these awkward rules questions.
It would be a miracle if the rules questions didn't exist.
I have to move. Let's talk about Killing Wave.
That was a miraculous recovery. Also a magic card. Killing Wave.
Not going to miss this.
They have to pay X life or sack. For every creature, they have to pay X life or sacrifice it.
Right.
Black X. And it works on both players, right?
Yes, each player. So, Damnation? Yes? No? Other Magic card? What is this thing?
Okay, it's not like any Magic card we've already seen, really, which is good. That's exciting. On the other hand, it is the Punisher mechanic. The Punisher mechanic is not a powerful mechanic. It is the opposite of a powerful mechanic. It is a punishing mechanic for the people who cast the cards. I think this card is sweet, and I think it's going to be good sometimes, but I also don't think that you can look at this and say it's a damnation. Because what it is an effect, two effects that really directly contradict each other. Whereas Vexing Devil, which we're going to talk about, you know, later, both halves the same deck wants. This card, you can't put in a blue-black control deck because you cast it for five, and they have four guys out. Okay, they'll pay 15 life, and they'll keep three of them. Like, that doesn't really help you, right? You're not killing them. Well, if you're casting it in, like, an aggressive deck, I mean, it hurts you. You might not have a ton of mana. Basically, for this to fit, you need some sort of, like, deck that cares about their life total a lot, but also plans to get up to a bunch of mana and is, like, the fact that they have a choice is just the worst.
Yes, yes.
You can count, generally, on your opponent making the choice that benefits them the most. Not always. We've obviously seen plenty of opponents who don't do that. But, so, the fact that it's not deal 12 or them sack three creatures, it's deal 12 or they sack three creatures, or they pay four and sack one creature, or sack two creatures, or they pay eight and sack one creature. Like, the fact that they get to choose which side of the sliding scale this is means that, like, it's just not going to do what you want at any point you want it.
If it had been an all or nothing kind of thing, it'd obviously be a lot better.
Yeah, I mean, I agree. If they'd said, like, they may pay X life or for each creature they control or sacrifice all their creatures, yes, because then their only choices are 12 or 0, and sometimes you can manipulate them into making one of those choices you want. But when it's 12, 8, 4, or 0, I mean, at one point on the curve, that's going to favor them, not you. And if, you know, they're reasonably intelligent, they're going to figure out which point that is.
Right, and that's not even talking about the, yeah, need to have a home. I mean, what kind of, there's no deck right now where it's like, I'm applying pressure that's probably not creature-based.
I mean, well, zombies could kind of use it because zombies is an aggressive deck, and the fact that you have to pay life for your own creatures is not the end of the world.
All of your messengers, you just, you do it for one, and then, you know, they all come
Well,
back.
No, or you do it for five and just sack your messengers anyway. And then they come back and sack your Gravecrawler. So that's kind of cool in zombies against other aggressive decks. But again, how much mana and how many creatures do they have in play for this to be really effective?
Again, like, you're talking about a zombies deck that has six mana in play?
Well, okay,
and they
well,
have this card in their hand the whole time?
What if they have four mana, right? Like, it's not, they get stuck on four. So they do it for three against a deck with three creatures in play. So they either sack two guys and take three, or take nine, or sack all their guys. You know, I could see this as like a one of in zombies, maybe a two of, just as like a late game fireball-esque board sweeper type effect. But I mean, look at how bad that is. Fireball board sweeper. When do you want one and not the other? Like,
yeah, it's a little awkward.
Is their life total super pressured, but them have a bunch of guys in play? You know, when are they, yeah, because if they're beating you down with a bunch of guys, they're just going to pay a life and kill you. And if they're on the defensive, they probably don't have a ton of guys in play. I don't know. It's weird.
Yeah. I mean, again, like, you look at it first, and the first thing is like, okay, well, what's the best scenario? I was like, well, if there's these black-white tokens decks everywhere where it's like gather, linger, and you have to, A, not be dead yet, and then they have to have, you know, six to eight guys in play, and then you're casually like, oh, do this for three, and they're like, okay, well, I'll keep the ones that fly, and these ones will die.
I mean,
and
like, yeah, wouldn't you rather just cast Black Sun Zenith a lot of the time?
Yeah.
And just a good rule of thumb, cards with Punisher on them are less good than they look because they always look pretty good. Because they're always under-costed for either side of the effect. If they're one or the other, they'd be way too good. But, you know, the fact that they get to choose is what really brings it down. So,
Not so much. Not getting the stamp of approval on that card, I don't think.
I can't do it. The stamp's almost out of ink.
That's weird. Then it must not be coming for Angel
of the... Oh, I stamped TSG's whole cube. Oh, wait, none of his cube gets a stamp of approval.
Terrible.
That's not true. I exaggerate. Like 30% of the cards I like.
Those are the red ones.
Okay.
Angel of Jubilation.
Yay! It's a sweet card.
It's triple white, so...
That's a lot of white.
Only Craig Wesco will cast it.
No, I mean, the way the mana fixing is right now in Standard, you can play this in a two-color deck. Say one that has black mana for Lingering Souls. Like, I mean, that's obviously where, you know, it kind of looks like it fits, right?
Yes. 3/3 flying, Crusade, you're non-black guys, what is it?
Non-black.
And then, you know, no player can pay life or creatures to cost of spells, I think is what it was.
Yeah, I don't know how that actually work against the card we just talked about. Like
the Killing Wave?
Yeah.
No, you're just paying mana for it. That's the spell.
Can they not pay life?
No, to cast the spells. It's just to cast the spells.
Okay.
So, for example,
You can't cast
Phyrexian Mana spells.
You can't cast Aldrich Reap, you can't cast Phyrexian Mana spells. I guess one of those is more relevant than the other, I would suspect, a little bit.
Obviously, Aldrich Reap. No. No Force of Wills.
Yeah, I suppose that's true. I don't know how often that's going to come up.
I don't think very.
But, I mean, it's a cool ability. It's a bonus, because, honestly, without that ability, the card would still be, like, pretty good. And with the ability, it just gets better. I mean, presumably, you're not trying to make a Gristlebrand Age of Jubilation deck.
No.
So that would be sweet.
Whatever. That's not much to say past that. Not a card you're probably going to cast. Let's be honest. You never know. You might, open it in Spain and have to draft it.
I played 14 planes at Pro Tour. 14 planes. Yeah. Maybe it was 12. But either way, it was a lot.
It's okay. I can remember, hey, do you have 2 planes on you? Like, what?
Like I said, I bought this giant stack of beta lands from you and then proceeded to, like, lose it over the course of a year.
And it's not even the losing. It was, I wish we could have recorded the conversation in which you were like, yeah, okay, I'm going to need 20 islands. I guess I might need 20 swamps. Give me, like, 4 forests. I don't know, like 12 mountains and, like, what, 4 planes? I can't imagine ever playing a deck that would play more than 4
planes.
Yeah,
then I had to buy a bunch when at the Pro Tour. It was worth it.
Let's talk about the big Glinthawk Idol. Or Halcyon Glaze, however you want to look at it.
I mean, 3 mana becomes a 3/3 flying angel. Is it a first strike? I think it's just flying.
No. Is it going to make it outside of limited here?
No, of course not. I mean, look at this card. It's not Glinthawk Idol. Glinthawk Idol costs 1 less, is a 4/4 because of Temperate Steel.
And you can activate it.
And you can activate it whenever you want. You can never flood out and just never be screwed on it. If this angel had an activation cost, it would be probably too much like Glinthawk Idol, but that is what it would take to make it good. Still wouldn't be good in Constructed. It is good in Limited, though, I think. Like, it's not insane. It's, again, not as good as Glinthawk Idol was in Scars, but it's still a 3/3 flyer. It's still a beatdown card. So, I don't know.
Any deck can play it a little bit better than Halcyon Glaze.
True.
Not a whole lot to say there. Let's move to one that will definitely have you saying something, I hope. Let's talk about Arcane Melee. Yep, you got me again. Do you even know what this one does?
No. I don't know the card names yet. I read all the cards. But
all right, it's a blue enchantment. It costs a blue and 4.
Oh, this is one that reduces all the spells. All instant sources, even your opponents, cost 2
less.
Yes.
The Mantanaz special.
It's a perfect sideboard card against stacks in Vintage. I mean, they cast Thorn of Amethyst and Sphere of Resistance. You cast this, just get them right back.
Even Webb's laughing.
Yeah, you can probably not hear it, but Webb is laughing. I consider it a success.
Yes.
So what does this card do? Well, something broken. I mean, everyone knows that. I mean, who knows what it does, but it's not going to be pretty.
It has symmetry, Luis. Everyone can
symmetry.
Use it.
Symmetry, woo! It is sweet. I mean, I like that they print cards like this because, every now and then they just become absolutely absurd. It's not a card you play in a fair deck. Let's just put it that way. There's no way that you're playing this card as just, well, I'm going to play this just to get a little value. It's like Saffron Medallion. You never played Saffron Medallion unless you're casting Cloud of Fairies and Snaps. Yes, at one point maybe there was a blue deck that just played it, but
Capsize for 5 was totally okay, and then Capsize for 4. I mean, these are things that happen.
Sure, but like in general, Saffron Medallion was played. I mean, I want a PTQ with it, going, Cloud of Fairies, Cloud of Fairies, Cloud of Fairies, Snap, Cloud of Fairies, Mind's Desire, Merchant Scroll, Brain Freeze you, boom.
So bringing this conversation a little more relevant to the card itself, and rather just PTQ
what does it do?
Wins, yeah.
Cast Lingering Souls for 1, then 1. No, I mean, I don't think it's quite at the level of like a Past in Flames where you'd put it in an extended Storm deck because, making Seething Song cost 1 is exciting, but Sleight of Hand still costs 1. And Desperate Ritual going from 2 to 1 is not that insane, though.
It's not worth a 5 mana enchantment.
You can splice it for 2, right? You can pay 2 mana and splice it. But yeah, it's not a 5 mana enchantment. You've already got Past in Flames as the 4 or 5 mana spell that ends the game when you've cast a bunch of rituals. And in this case, you cast Arcane Melee, then you want to cast Rituals. So, what is it going to be in? I don't know. I don't have, like, a deck off the top of my head, but if it isn't a deck, it's not going to be pretty.
But, no, I mean, the important thing is, looking at the spoiler, there's nothing where you see it and you're immediately like, oh, well, it could work with this thing that already exists, or it opens up this other space for this thing.
I think they costed it fairly conservatively at 5 mana. Like, it's going to be hard for a 5 mana enchantment to be broken, considering you have to untap that, right? Like, it's no Mirari's Wake. I really hope it's good and limited. You know how absurd of a format it would be if this card was good and limited?
That'd be pretty sweet.
That would be awesome. I mean, I'm trying to think. In a Burning Vengeance deck, I don't know if you'd even play this, and that's like the closest we'd get to something like that, but who knows? You would have played it in the old Dampen Thought deck in Champions, probably. They played the Go High or whatever, the 3-mana artifact that makes all the spells 1 cheaper, so maybe they'd play a 5-mana one to make it 2 cheaper.
It's a shame that we only have the one set. I mean, this is one of those times where you would actually have benefit from a 3-set draft. Because we only have the 244 cards, and you have to have all these things in limited variants.
Yeah, yeah. It depends on the size, yeah.
I mean, I just don't.
I mean, the Dampened Thought deck goes better in Triple Champions than anything else. So if the card is there,
so if there's like
you want a lot of
one or two key like milieu or it's more likely for there to be a mill effect than a recurring shock effect.
Yes, I agree with that. Good read.
So yeah, it could happen.
You can cast Killing Wave for a lot more now.
Ooh, is that our joke card from this set? Is that what I've really thinking about it? Nothing.
You're killing it.
Let's talk about one of the Soulbound guys here, and one that's common, and obviously going to be something that's going to be in Limited, and you already mentioned it already. We have the Nightshade Peddler.
Oh, I'm pretty excited about this guy in Limited, because, I mean, obviously the idea is that you play him, you Soulbound, you trade that guy off, you play another guy, you Soulbound, you trade that guy off. Like, you just have an endless stream of, like, little guys that now get Death Touch, because obviously the Nightshade Peddler by himself, well, does nothing, it's just a 1-1, but you don't really, I mean, you could trade him off too. Like, you can play him as, Typhoid Rats and block, and then you still, 2-mana 1 on Death Touch is not the end of the world. I think Soulbound's a really interesting mechanic. It's going to play well in Limited, I think. It rewards you for pairing creatures correctly. It rewards you for knowing when to trade off those creatures to pair another creature. Like, because you can't pair unless one of the first pair dies. Like, if you play a Nightshade Peddler and pair it with a guy, and you play another guy, you don't get to pair it right. The first one actually has to die first.
No, I think you have the option to.
Oh, you can always just
move to the next one.
Okay, well, that's a little better of an ability, a little easier to play with. So, but either way, it's still going to be pretty fun to play with.
I think so. And from the ones that we've seen so far, the choices we could make, the ones to talk about, this one is common. The fact that it has Death Touch changes, it can change combat a lot. It can change the way your deck plays a lot. Yeah. I think it works out pretty well. I mean, the joke was banding again or some kind of variety, but this actually looks a lot better.
It's much cleaner than banding.
Well,
people understand how it is.
Anything is cleaner than
banding. I love banding. It's so good. It's the best ability.
Because no one else knows what it does.
Right. And if you played in any of the Master's Edition drafts or Mirage drafts where on Magic Online where they still have banding creatures, banding creatures are like mini Visaras. You play a banding creature and they're guaranteed to throw at least two creatures into it, if not more. I've had a guy lose a creature 3 turns in a row to three different banding tricks because, banding. It is not... Yeah, it's a great ability.
New Goblin Guide, everyone.
Ooh, Vexing Devils? Okay, first of all, it's not Goblin Guide, and that's only because Goblin Guide is like here, and every other red one drop is here. I'm not unhappy that it's not Goblin Guide. I've died so many times to Goblin Guide, you can't even imagine.
New Furnace Scamp?
Better than that.
Okay, right. So we're like,
so going on to the Punisher mechanic, this time the halves both make sense. It's not like a... When you're playing with the old Punisher cards, like the old six, they take 6 damage or it's Wrath in Odyssey Block. I don't even remember what it was called.
Breaking Point.
And see there, a deck does not want either of those. Like, the same deck's generally not going to want both halves. Well, the same deck wants both halves of Vexing Devil. It's pretty sweet. 1-mana 4/3, or they take 4 damage. I mean, yes, at the different points in the game, it's going to get better or worse. Like, but it's going to do pretty close to what you want it to do in most decks. Like, in the burn deck, it's going to be, like in Legacy in particular, 1-mana 4 damage. You're in the market for that. And until the late game, it's still going to be good as a creature. They're going to pay the 4 life most of the time, which is exactly what you want. I mean, its weakness comes when they've built up a bunch of creature removal spells in their hand, and you're trying to peel burn, and you play that, they're like, okay, kill it. But anytime in the first 3 or 4 turns, it's good as gold. I think it's fine.
I think it's a little above average there because again, even late in the game, your deck's still gonna have Jackal Pups and.
Well, no, they don't play Jackal Pups.
Well, the card's similar to that. You're like,
they're gonna have Goblin Guide. They're gonna have maybe Figure of Destiny, but they're not gonna have like, both those are in a lot of ways better than 1-mana 4/3, especially if like you're playing against combo and you have 1 turn to kill them. They're at 2. You'd rather peel a Goblin Guide than a Vexing Devil. On the other hand, depending on what they have out, Vexing Devil might be big enough to brawl with their creatures. But if they have just a Tarmogoyf out, I don't know, sometimes you don't really want this. As for its fate and standard, well, we'll see about that. I mean, if there's an aggressive deck, this card is pretty good. Like, the both halves of damage are pretty decent. I'm not saying the card is great, and again, it's a Punisher card. They're always worse than they look, but it still looks pretty decent.
I mean, as long as Celestial Purge and Timely Reinforcements are in standard, it's really hard to put red on the map.
Yeah, both those cards punish red pretty heavily, but this card's going to be around even after M12 rotates.
Right.
And I don't know about Purge. Purge is fine. That doesn't... Vexing Devil doesn't care about Celestial Purge very much.
No, I'm just saying, like, there are...
Time Reinforcements is a giant beating, and that I agree with.
Yes.
I would not be surprised if it left, just because of what it does to the format. Only good things, though.
You're a timely reinforcement.
Oh
fan.
Yeah, I like timely reinforcements quite a bit.
The last card we have on today's list of spoilers, we have Sagara, Host of Heroines.
Oh yes, it's Heroines, not Heroines, probably.
Thank you, autocorrect.
Yep. So she's super hexproof, right? She's hexproof and can't be edicted.
Yes.
See, like, when I saw this card on Twitter, I was like, I don't like this card, and people were like, you know, then like, you know, braiding me. They're like, no, this card's not too powerful. You got lingering souls. You should be doing better things. It's just a 5/5 vanilla. Like, why are you complaining? And let me clarify. I don't think this card is overpowered. I think this card is fine to print. It's like Thrun. It's good against some decks and, you know, tough to deal with, but by no means the end of the world. That being said, I know it's a card that's going to kill me a lot more than the other way around. So I'm just saying, like, this card. So it's a fine card. I just, I anticipate dying to it.
Not your new EDH general of choice. Not like, oh, I think I could play it. When was the last time you played a deck with four? Like, well, no, I guess you have played a deck with Forest and Plains in the same deck when they cast Wild and Coddle. But you haven't played like a green-white deck of any variety.
Not since a Pro Tour a couple years ago. A Pro Tour that shall remain nameless. Part of the big problem with this card, and you'll probably see it come into its own later, is when Phyrexian Metamorph, and Phantasmal Image rotate out. Because, honestly, ruling Legends seems like such a cop-out with clone effects, especially two-mana clone effects. Like, they go through all this trouble making a hexproof guy that they can't be sacrificed, and Phantasmal Image it. So that's kind of lame, even though I also think I'll be on the Phantasmal Image side of that particular interaction. But, yeah, I mean, this card's decent. Unlike something like Sphinx of Jawar Isle, it fits the top of the curve much better of a deck that's already going to want to curve out, and it's one cheaper, and it can't be Liliana or Tributed, which, you know, is pretty reasonable.
Yeah, these things are relevant.
Yeah, yeah. I mean, it is going to have a hard time battling through Lingering Souls. That's true of, like, any card, any deck.
Things to take away from this spoiler episode.
I mean, Lingering Souls is good. What can I say?
We'll go a little bit bigger picture here to close out, though. We haven't seen that many cards from the set, but from what you've seen, is there anything that's kind of popping out to you for the block format that's going to be relevant in about a month?
I mean, a lot of these, like, Vexing Devil does provide ammunition if there's a really fast red deck, but I don't know. I mean, that's a card that really only goes into, like, a narrow subset of decks. So far, haven't seen any sweet mana fixing, because that's something that would be nice. Even though there's a good amount in block already, but more would always be better.
Some promises were made to us that we would kind of see the rest of that cycle of lands that did stuff, but that is not mana fixing.
Well, yeah, no, that's the opposite of mana fixing. Yeah. That's mana straining, but those lands are also exciting, obviously. I don't know. I think overall, like, the cards we've seen so far, like, the Miracle cards are interesting. They're powerful. They're worth considering if they reprint Brainstorm and Upset Restores.
The obvious question about all of those cards, though, is how many of them would you ever play for their actual casting cost?
None. That's the problem. They're not just that card. They're obviously both halves. But they're a high variance card, which is exciting, again. It's, you know, Mind Stab and Limited, right? Where at 6 mana, it was just terrible. And at 1 mana, it was, like, pretty good. So, yeah, we'll see what else block gets. Like, the Double Strike and the Soulbound guy is not too bad. Like, white, 1/2/2, Soulbound, Double Strike. Just because you play him and immediately do 2 to 3 extra damage, and then, you know, he's a Double Striker himself. Angel of Jubilation also seems very good, like, just with Lingering Souls in particular. Well, I guess in block it's not going to have Lingering Souls.
There we go.
But it's still going to have other cards to work with. And it's still
Gather the Townsfolk.
It's still a powerful card.
Turn 2, Gather. Turn 3, the Soulbound guy. Turn 4, the...
Yeah, bam. That's, like, a ton of damage. But 10 damage? 12 damage.
Some damage. So I already see this Pro Tour shaping up. There's going to be a lot of people playing these White Weenie decks, and you'll be casting Desperate Ravings.
It really... Well... That's possible. It depends on what else is in Avacyn Shore. Still have a ton of cards.
Yeah, I know. I'm just trying to
200 cards.
I'm trying to, you know, put the picture together. It's, you know, Wesco with the white mana symbols and you miracling off of Desperate Ravings all the time.
I really hope so. So yeah, we'll check back as more spoilers come out. And yeah, enjoy. Thanks for watching. True.
Shut up. Three, two.
Rolling. And scene.
And speed.
And speed.